Tēnā koutou katoa, Ngā mihi nui kia koutou ki te kaupapa nui ki tēnei pō. No mai, haere mai. Welcome everybody. My name is Nicola Tuki. I am the Chief Executive of Forest Mere Tere O Te Taiao. It's a real pleasure to have so many of you here with us this evening. We have some serious business to discuss, and we are very interested to hear from you all this evening. I'm very keen to bring our context to the table, but before we do that, he tikanga, he karakia. Mā te whakapono, mā te tūmanako, mā te tiro, mā te whakarongo, mā te mahi tahi, mā te manawa nui, mā te aroha, ka taea e mātou. And as you can see, that means by believing and trusting, by having faith and hope, by looking and searching, by listening and hearing, by working and striving together, by patience and perseverance, by all being done with love, we will succeed, which is pretty apt for Forest and Bird 100 years down the track in terms of the work that we have done and we continue to do to give nature a voice here in Aotearoa, New Zealand. I am conscious that we have some big work to do, and before we get into the nuts and bolts of that, and particularly the technical advice that my team are going to bring to you today, I just really want to talk about the situation that we find ourselves in terms of this fast track legislation. So, we have never in the history of both New Zealand and Forest and Bird seen legislation, proposed legislation like this before, and we are facing some significant headwinds with respect to the challenges that the fast track proposed legislation brings us in our communities and the nature that we love in the communities that we reside in, to the extent that we have not seen anything like this before. And we'll talk to you a bit more about this throughout the course of the evening. Before we do that, I'll take you through a little bit about what we're going to do, and just the little bit of housekeeping that I have for you this evening is we will be looking for questions at the end, which we will be very happy to answer, and you can provide those through the app through the through Zoom, and you can, and I've seen some of you do it already, you can use reactions to let us know how you're feeling about these the things we're talking to you about today. So, I guess hello, nice to see you all. So many of you will have heard about and read about this fast track legislation. This is not like fast track legislation that we have seen before, and we'll take you through that through the course of the evening. And back at you, by the way, it's lovely to see all your interactions. So, this situation puts at stake the very thing that defines us here in this country, and we are very clear that this is not something that New Zealanders have ever and will ever tolerate with respect to what that means for not just our natural heritage and but the impact of this on our DNA and what nature means to us in New Zealand, even if most of us live in urban environments. We need to stand up at this moment. And it is 100 years down the track for Forest and Bird. It is a time, it is a crucial time in our history, and never have we needed Forest and Bird's voice for nature more than we do right now when we are faced with a piece of legislation so abhorrent to nature and so appalling in terms of its consequences that cannot be unwound or undone once the damage is done. And we need every voice that we can get to be able to stop it in its tracks, give ministers the message that they need to hear loud and clear that this is not something that any New Zealander voted for, wants, is going to tolerate, and will not stand for. So I will let some of my most senior and experienced staff talk you through what that means in terms of the technical aspects of that of that legislation. But I want to talk a bit about the fact that right now New Zealand is having this conversation with itself about who we are as a nation, and we are in a once in a lifetime kind of opportunity in terms of taking a stand at a time when we're all busy people running busy lives, and we kind of have lost a little bit of what we've had in the past. And many of you on this call will have been involved in actions and activities that have made monumental changes to firming up the protections and controls and checks and balances that nature needs in New Zealand to give it a voice. Because at Forest and Bird, we're not here with a vested interest. We don't have a big pile of money behind us pushing developments forward. We are here for, as I said to my colleagues at WWF and EDS and Greenpeace the other day, we're here for big nature, right? We are here for the intangible, for the things that define us. And I think as New Zealanders, no matter what, we're not going to stand for this being taken away in a moment for a fast buck, in such a way that future generations cannot benefit from the things that we hold dear to us today. So I really, really value all of the support and the help that you are bringing to the table. I want you talking to your communities. I want you out there talking to your MPs. I want them to hear loud and clear that whatever they think their mandate is, nobody voted for species extinction. And that is what we are facing with no more checks and balances. It is like driving a car at 150 kilometers an hour down a highway with no seat belts and no brakes. It is unacceptable for a country who prides itself and drives its export earnings on the image we sell to the world on what we stand for and who we are, to suddenly say we're going to override the Conservation Act, the Wildlife Act, any fisheries regulations, any regulations that came before, any court cases that were well and hard fought and won over and over and over again. And while the ministers might say they're here to disrupt the system, they have a mandate to disrupt the system, no one in this country gave them the mandate to overrule the justice system. And so never have we needed you more. And I know it's late in the evening. I know you've probably all had extraordinarily busy days. I know I have, but I cannot commend you enough for committing to being with us here today. So we will continue to support you to be able to get the message out there to give nature a voice here in New Zealand while we face these significant headwinds. You will hear, for example, that this is just like the COVID fast track. It's not. You will hear that Forest and Bird opposes fast tracks. We don't. We can see that there are a role for fast track sometimes with the appropriate checks and balances in place. We have, made our work for the last century or more sitting around the table with every flavour of government to secure outcomes for nature. I personally don't mind who's in power, as long as we are able to have those conversations to give nature a voice, because nature can't stand up for itself. But we are not going to stand by and tolerate the stripping of benefit of the protections for nature that we all hold so dear, that we have international obligations for, and that drive the very foundations of our economy, whether that's farming, whether that's tourism, whether that's carbon sequestration. Spoiler alert, we have quite a big bill coming up, something to do with the Paris Agreement, and if we can't actually protect and invest in the things that we have here, we're going to have to pay a lot of taxpayer money offshore for dodgy offsets where we could have actually been doing it at home by having an investment mindset into the natural world, to tile this place that defines us. And I think this government have got an opportunity to listen to that, because this government campaigned on local decision making at place, getting decisions out of Wellington. This bill takes all of that away. This bill takes your voice away, takes our voice away, strips mana whenua voices of their rights and responsibilities at place with respect to whether or not they've settled. And we want to make sure that if we're going to put laws into place, we do so with the appropriate checks, balances, and controls that any high functioning democracy should have. So I just really want to thank you all for your time, but I also want to say that this isn't a one-off. So we're going to need to stick into this both most urgently between now and the 19th of April, and then for the long haul. And this is going to take all of us using our voices for nature in all of the places we are to make it clear that, you know, we're not against regulation. We actually quite like it, but we want regulation that isn't unbridled and puts power in the hands of ministers in the way that New Zealand has never seen before. I don't know if you saw the piece on Radio New Zealand this morning, but it talked, one of the most senior law professors at the University of Otago talked about the fact that this extends beyond the powers of the Muldoon government. We've gone past that, right? We've grown up. We are beyond that, and we have responsibilities to Te Tāio, not just for now, but for our generations that come after us, that come after them, that come after them, that come after them. And we've all seen what happens when we make a fast buck by destroying the nature for a moment and leaving our communities in the lurch and the taxpayers to pick up the tab. So we're going to take you through what that means for us at Forest and Bird, and how we can support you to support us to give nature that voice over the course of the next little while. I want to talk to you about the Archie's frog. And the reason that I want to do that is it's fresh in my mind. I'm in Wellington this week. I've been, you know, doing my good work, meeting with ministers. I have met with Minister Jones, for example. And you will be aware that we've had some rhetoric from this government. And let me be clear, Minister Jones is a minister of this government. I've seen a little bit in the media where this has sort of been an attempt to distract and delay and sort of put off the fact that, oh no, that's Minister Jones' position, that's New Zealand First position. No, they signed a coalition agreement that is a government position, right? Minister Jones said stewardship land is not dock land. And if there is a mineral, if there is a mining opportunity and it's impeded by a blind frog, goodbye, Freddy. Are we actually at that point in New Zealand? Have we reached the point where we are prepared to make a deliberate decision to make a species extinct in a country that has the highest proportion of threatened species in the world? Because that is the question. That is the moral question we are wrestling with. And I think that is something that we should all be challenging our local decision makers about. Are we ready to deliberately draw a line through a species and say, we've chosen to write you off the planet because for now we need to dig some holes? I don't think that's something any New Zealander, no matter what values and principles you hold from a political point of view, and the joy of working for Forest and Bird is we don't mind, right? We're independent. And very deliberately so, and have been for 100 years, but no New Zealander that I've ever met would agree to a deliberate extinction of any species, least of all the Archie's frog, which many of you on this call will know is the most, bear with me, evolutionary distinct genetically, there's an E word there that someone's going to chip in. We have a frog that is the most ancient species of frog of all the frogs in the world that just happens to live in a place that this government, ministers of this government, because the coalition is a government, have decided that they would say goodbye, Freddie, to. And I don't think New Zealanders have agreed to that. This is tonight is about making our voices heard about exactly that. So rather than hear from much more from me, although I will come back and answer your questions at the end, I'm really keen to pass you on to my team. We're going to start with Peter, who's our general counsel and chief lawyer extraordinaire, who's going to take us through the ramifications of the bill, what that means, and then Richard, who's our group manager for advocacy and communications, is going to talk you through the opportunities of what we can do to turn this around. And what's great about this is this ain't my first rodeo with Forest and Bird, right? So 14 years ago, I joined Forest and Bird as a somewhat bright-eyed and bushy-tailed advocate. And within a few weeks of my job, I went on my very first protest. 40,000 New Zealanders marched with me up Queen Street, and we changed the government's mind, and they backed down on their opportunity to mine in national parks. We're there again, and we're going to need all of your help. So without further ado, I will pass you on to Pete, and I look forward to your questions at the end. Thanks, everybody.
Kia ora koutou. My name is Peter Anderson. I'm Forest and Birds General Counsel, and can just move to the next slide. Before we get into the weeds of what this is all about, what I want to say is that the government's wobbly on this. They think it's a wonderful idea, but there's been pressure brought on by all sides. We've put pressure on, other NGOs have put pressure on, the legal fraternity have put pressure on, and so what we need to do is keep that pressure on, and we need everyone to do it. Like, us as the professional staff, we'll be putting in submissions and talking, but we need everyone at the lower levels to be doing the same. You know, local responses to this, local submissions on particular projects, if we get the information. So really want to endorse everyone putting their bit in. So in terms of, it's important to understand what it is we're actually talking about when we talk about this fast track bill. So the guts of it is in the purpose: facilitate the delivery of infrastructure and development projects with significant regional or national benefits. Nothing about the environment. So I'm going to get onto it later, but really this is about any project with economic benefits getting the tick, irrespective of what the harm is. And so what this has been characterised by Forest and Bird and other NGOs is a war on nature. You know, the war on nature, what? That's the repeal of the NBA. They've already done that. There's this. And next, and kind of equally as worrying, is what's the new RMA going to look like, a property rights-based bit of legislation that's scary times for nature. Can we move to the next slide, please? So what else have we seen in this war on nature? So the changes to freshwater protections and SNAs, we'll have seen the stuff last week about just unilaterally stopping the councils doing the identification of SNAs and district plans, really detrimental environmental outcomes. 25-year extension to consents for aquaculture, just no consideration of anything, we're just going to do it. And then the climate's given a very rough deal. The ETS and where dairy farmers, where farming fits in, and using the climate fund to pay for tax cuts and new offshore oil and gas exploration. This is serious time for our nature with this government just riding roughshod over it all. Can we have the next slide, please? So what are we? Let's give some indications of what we're talking about. So they talk about a fast track, and that gives the idea. Well, actually, they're just going to, you know, make the process go quicker, but it's not about that at all. It's about changing the outcomes. They're intentionally removing the environmental protections that are present in the current legislation, the RMA, the Conservation Act, the EZ Act, and they're replacing those with a deliberate priority on on the economy. So what are we going to see? We're going to see a whole pile of projects that are terribly environmentally destructive. We're probably going to see them get a fast track, and not just a quicker ride to an answer, a different ride, an outcome where they get consent where they otherwise wouldn't. Te Kūha, you'll probably be familiar with us talking about that. That's the coal mine on the West Coast, which went to the Environment Court. The Environment Court declined it on an appeal from Forest and Bird. The word on the street is that's got a fast track. It didn't get consent under the RMA. It'll probably get one if it gets a fast track. The Ruatanifa Dam, you might have been familiar from that from a few years ago, where they're proposing to do a dam which will inundate part of conservation land. Didn't get across the line. We took the case to the Supreme Court. They'll get it. The Act express, and I'll talk about this a little bit more. The Act expressly reverses that Supreme Court decision. They'll get their exchange if they get a fast track. Trans-Tasman Resources, previously declined is probably a stretch on that because it got granted, but it's gone all the way to the Supreme Court in terms of appeals, and it looks pretty marginal. But that's where they're going to suck up 35 square kilometres of seabed, put it on the boat, take out the minerals, and then dump it back in with huge impacts from the sediment plume on the environment. That they'll go through the fast track, and they'll probably get a consent. That's what we're talking about here. Next page, please. So there are, as we get on to, there's two types of projects. There's referred projects where there's certain criteria in the Act, and these projects then get referred by ministers. And the referral decision is based on economic grounds. So that's significant regional or national benefits. The environmental impacts are not taken into consideration when deciding whether or not a project is referred. So what does that mean? That means that no project with an impact too severe would be excluded. And we heard Nick talk before about the Oceania mine with potential impacts on Archer's Frog and extinction level effects. The same applies for Te Kūha with the forest ringlet butterfly. Those impacts do not prevent a fast track. Can I have the next slide, please? And so the second type of project, which is probably even more troubling because they're more difficult to challenge, is the listed project. So the project, the legislation is going to have a list of projects which get a fast track. They don't need to be referred, they just get fast track. And so this list, you would normally expect on legislation that the list of projects will be put in with the bill that goes to the select committee. And what I reckon is a pretty cynical call, the government has decided that it's not going to put that list. The list is in the bill. It's not open for public scrutiny. It's likely to be interested in what's called a supplementary order paper. So that goes in after the select committee process, no public scrutiny. So we get the list after we have made a comment and we're not able to comment on it. That's pretty undemocratic in my humble opinion. We've heard the rumours about what's on it. We've heard about Te Kūha being on it. We've heard about TTR on it. We've heard about Ruatanifa being on it. We've heard about the Wairarapa Dam project, which wouldn't pass scrutiny. They had to withdraw that application. The list goes on about projects that are going to be on this fast track. Can I have the next slide, please? This is one of the really important ones. It's the Oceania gold operation, the Coromandel. Bye-bye, Freddie. All the suggestions are this will get a fast track. So we have a mine that gets through without the environmental protections that we hold so dear and we want to be maintained. Can I have the next slide, please? So what happens to a referred project? A referred project gets referred to an expert panel. That expert panel makes recommendations on whether fast tracks projects proceed. This isn't a level playing field. This isn't a consideration of the project on its merits under whatever bit of legislation would apply. You're not deciding whether the Te Kūha mine gets its consent under the RMA. The panel has to prioritise the delivery of infrastructure and development projects with significant regional and or national benefits. over all other considerations, that is what matters when it comes to making decisions. Environmental impacts are secondary at best. Can I have the next slide, please? And so what does the panel do when it's considering these applications? The first thing is on almost all of these projects under the current RMA and various other bits of legislation, concessions, Crown Minerals Act, the public would have the right to comment on them. The big projects, the RMA says, if it's a big project, there's public notification and anyone can submit on it. So the bill says no limit to public notification. So the general public do not get the opportunity to comment. There's a limited range of people who are invited to comment. Forest and Bird is not one of those. Under the COVID fast track legislation, we are specifically identified as a party up which comments are sought from, and we have been active in commenting on those fast tracks that impact on the matters that are important to us. So things like, you know, biodiversity, and that process has not been that bad. The terrible projects haven't come through and got approved. Some have been declined. The panel isn't required to have a hearing, and it can receive comments from other parties, but it's not obliged to do so. So effectively what that means is that there'll be a limited range of people that will have the opportunity to comment. It'll be councils, it'll be some government departments, it'll be landowners, and it'll potentially, and I say potentially, be affected iwi. That's not entirely clear. The voice of those that want to protect the environment for the environment's sake would only do so if the panel chooses to, and I think it's pretty unlikely. Can I have the next slide, please? And so then we've got the three wise men that we've got here. So the expert panel makes recommendations depending on the project. If it's a mine, it'll probably go to Shane Jones. If it's infrastructure, it'll go to Chris Bishop, and it's transport, it'll go to Simeon Brown. Conservation, not really in the picture, except a limited role in relation to Conservation Act ones. And I'll just leave it to you to decide whether those gentlemen are going to make decisions that are going to look after the things we hold so dear. Can you move to the next slide? This is a one-stop shop for a number of statutory approvals. It's not just the RMA. So the COVID fast tracks were just RMA approvals, so you'd get a resource consent. This fast track bill provides for consenting for a broader range of consents. So there's resource consents under the RMA. Obviously, there's also concessions and Wildlife Act approvals under the you can see that across the bottom there. Wildlife Act, that's worrying. Freshwater Fisheries Regulations, Reserves Act, Heritage New Zealand, Pohiri Tauanga Act, the EEZ and Continental Shelf Act, that's a really worrying one, because the provisions they've got in relation to that current bit of legislation reflects international law and has some pretty solid environmental protections in, as we saw in the TTR case, which they talked about material harm. There's some pretty radical provisions in there about not even if the activity requires a marine consent and an RMA consent for being within the 12-mile limit, it's only the marine consent that matters. All those from RMA protections, such as the NZCPS, gone. Crown Minerals Act, some Crown Minerals Act approvals, Fisheries Act, and Public Works Act. So this is a million miles away from the fast track COVID stuff, which was limited approvals for RMA for projects that didn't tend to be that terrible. Can I have the next slide, please? Right, and so what is our key concern? This is really our key concern. Those key safeguards that are contained in the RMA and the Conservation Act, they're gone. So under the RMA, for consents that are fast tracked, the requirements of the RMA for protection of the environment, including biodiversity, are secondary to an economic consideration. So the most important thing for the panel to consider is this: what's this going to do for our economy? That's Yeah. So on that basis, if you look to Kuhar might do something for the economy, it's going to do bad things for the environment. The economy is deliberately prioritized over the environment. The Conservation Act, that could, I mean, I don't know if that could be worse, but it could be worse. They've deliberately, what's the word they use, disapplied many of the protections in the Conservation Act for concessions. So there's requirements and concessions. One, the key one is the activity can't be contrary to the purpose for which the land is held. That protection is disapplied. So you can now get you can fast track a concession that is contrary to the purpose for which the land is held, which you couldn't currently do. So if anyone tells you this fast track process is only about getting consents quicker for infrastructure, that's just not true. And in the Wildlife Act, so we can now compensate for harm for wildlife on fast-tracked activities, and bearing in mind what compensation might mean to the three wise men, we can't hold much hope that the Wildlife Act will protect our wildlife, which is what it's supposed to do. EEZ Act consent, so that's TTR, Trans-Tasman Resources. So the fast track is the primary purpose when you determine whether or not to grant a fast track consent for EEZ. It's the economic development which is the primary purpose, and as I kind of alluded to before, under the EEZ Act, you sometimes need activities will sometimes be between the EEZ and the RMA. So the 12 mile limit is the limit between the RMA and the EEZ. Projects often straddle the two. What they say is, if you need a marine consent, we don't look at the RMA. The key protections of the RMA, sections 6 and 7, they don't apply. And critically, the NZCPS, which says avoid adverse effects on significant biodiversity, gone. Avoid significant adverse effects on outstanding natural character, gone. So, and those are the critical arguments against TTR. TTR probably won't get its consent. I speculate about that, but the argument the Forest and Birds are putting up is TTR can't get a consent because it breaches the bottom lines in the NZCPS for natural character under this Act. Doesn't matter. They can still get their consent. Next slide, please. What else are we worried about? Climate change, the existential threat. The bill doesn't talk about climate change. It's not aligned to the climate change targets, and there's a deliberate inclusion of projects that are anti-carbon emissions, such as Te Kuhar. We know that digging coal out of the ground. We know that's going to be burnt. We know that's going to put greenhouse gases into the atmosphere. It's going to impact on our climate. That doesn't matter. That can still get a fast track. Can I have the next slide, please? Right, to conservation land. So many of you will recall the Ruatanifa decision. The Minister of Conservation granted a land exchange for an area of conservation park that would be inundated by the dam. Forest and Bird took a judicial review of that. That rocked all the way up to the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court reversed the Minister's decision, found for the Forest and Bird, and said, you can't have your dam. It's specially protected land. That means something. You can't exchange that to allow for the inundation of it by a dam. So where do we end up with fast track? So there is a statutory override in relation to fast tracks of that Ruatanifa dam decision. You can exchange that the specially protected land, for example, that was the Ruatanifa dam would inundate. That's expressly provided for as part of the process. So there are exceptions for those things. So national park, like the most important land is excluded. So national parks, national reserves. But as Nick mentioned earlier, stewardship land, there's a massive amount of stewardship land, which varies from the most important, up there with the most important in the country, Denison Plateau, found nowhere else on earth, to, some stuff that maybe shouldn't be conservation land because it's, forestry land that inadvertently went to DOC. But this doesn't distinguish. This says any of that land can now be exchanged, including some of the specially protected stuff, if the ministers think it's a good idea. So what does that mean? Bad stuff. More conservation land is vulnerable. The Denison Plateau looks in trouble. Can I have the next slide, please? So I'm just about to pass to Richard. Before I do so, this is a glorious picture of Te Kuha. If they get their way, that will be there will not be nice nature on top of that mountain. There will be a large coal mine, and the nice nature will be gone. The forest ringed butterfly, largest population known anywhere, likely to become nationally critical. Evidence we took to the Environment Court was this, that could lead to the extinction of that species. That's not it could, because it's so vulnerable, but that's what we're talking about. So that's why we need to do all we can do, and we need everyone else to do all they can do, and the government is vulnerable on it. We need to push, and we might get what we want. Richard, I'm going to pass to you now to carry on the rallying cry.
Okay, thanks, Peter. Kia ora koutou, everybody. And if we need a reminder as to why we're here and why this is worth fighting for, it is that picture. So next slide, please. So where are we at with the bill, and where are we at with this fight? So the bill has passed its first reading, and it's been referred to the Select Committee. What's really, really important for all of us is that public submissions are due on the 19th of April. And I'll talk a little bit about how we can support you to get those local submissions in, and the action that we're taking nationally, and that we want to support you to take locally, so that we can really stand up and fight for nature around this. I'd also note that actually at the Select Committee time, we still don't have that list. So as Nick said, this isn't just about fighting for nature. Actually, there's some fundamental questions about fighting for democracy, fighting for constitutional processes here, that we've got all sorts of allies coming out who are not just upset about what this means for the environment, but also what are upset about what it means for accountability, for transparency, and for how we want to run our country. These are very dark days in that respect. And I think these are some of the pressure points that we can use to bring allies together to say, this isn't on and it needs to stop. Next slide, please. So where to? Select Committee is going to hold public hearings on submissions. And this is the opportunity for not just Forest and Bird, but for other concerned people to get in front of the Select Committee and make sure that we're standing up and making our voice heard for nature. So the Select Committee will hear those issues raised in the submissions and may recommend changes. So parliamentary process can work in our favour in this respect. The bill will then go back to the House for further consideration before enactment. We're talking about 6 months of time here. So the immediate pressure is around submissions, and then we've got a longer period where Parliament itself will be considering this. So it's not just about the next month. It's also about standing up and putting pressure on people, and in particular on local MPs, to really make sure that our voices are heard around this. So I'll come to that a little bit more. Next, please. So what do we want to achieve here? So I think this is really important. Number one, we want this to stop. Okay? This is not a, we want this to change, we want this to stop. It is that bad. So we want to lobby ministers, MPs, and other interests to stop the bill and push for new legislation. Okay? So when we talk about other interests, if you think about local businesses in your communities, who is going to be really upset by a big development or some of these projects happening? There will be tourism operators who will not like the idea of that pristine bit of bush or big trucks coming down through that area. There will be local businesses who will be concerned. They are your allies as well. Local MPs, if you've got national MPs, this is your chance to target them. Make it very clear that you are unhappy about this, but you're unhappy about the fact that your voice won't be heard. So are they prepared to actually condone legislation and condone an approach that silences their own community? So you can put pressure on them. What's our next goal? Well, reduce harm. We will work within the parliamentary process to get environmental protections in place. So this is where Peter and his team and our colleagues and other supporters in the wider ENGO movement, constitutional lawyers, people in the science community will be standing up and saying, hang on, we need to change things. So we'll be trying to reduce harm. Next slide, please. The other thing we're doing is looking at what are all the legal and advocacy channels that we've got at our disposal to delay and minimize the damage. So we'll be looking at challenging the process, and we'll be looking to challenge the projects. So what powers do we have where we can try and absolutely stop this stuff, whether it's by challenging it on a question of law or by challenging it in terms of its impact? We'll use every avenue we can. The other thing we do, and we need your help with this, is to mobilize, right? We need to galvanize public opinion, not just in the environmental movement, but beyond that, against this legislation, and see this for what it is, which is it is the first fight in that wider war on nature. So I think, as Pete said, we are already seeing the government is rattled about this. We've been kicking up a big stink, and they are concerned. They are hearing from all sorts of people that they are, and they're being made to feel uncomfortable. That is what we want. We want them to realize that, as Nick said, you know, the environment is incredibly precious to New Zealanders, and we're going to stand up and fight for it. Next slide, please. So what else are we doing at Forest and Vert? Well, we've been meeting with government. So, you know, Nick was actually in with the Prime Minister yesterday, meetings with Chris Bishop, with Tama Putaka, with Penny Simmons, with Shane Jones. We're in their faces, talking to them, expressing our concerns, trying to give them alternatives. So this isn't just a case of, as we've said, it's not just a case of no fast track under any circumstances ever. It's saying, hang on, there's a fast track system that was in place, which actually worked was working okay. We're open to change. We're open to reform of the RMA. In fact, many of us have been working on that for a very long time. But this is not that. This is a fundamentally different piece of legislation with a fundamentally different purpose. And we're not going to stand for that. Also meeting with officials, gathering as much information as we can. A lot of official information act requests, as you can imagine. So really, really digging into DOC and Ministry of the Environment in particular. Also reaching out within the wider parliamentary community. So to Party Māori, Labour Party, Greens. So who in opposition can we work with? This leads to very interesting parliamentary questions put forward what we've been able to support. So we are looking to engage in the parliamentary process to try and bring transparency and scrutiny to these things. And we'll continue to do that as well. Next slide, please. And the other thing that you will have seen is hopefully a lot of good profile in the media. We are kicking up a stink about this as much as we can. So really making it clear to people and telling that story to New Zealanders that this is something they should be worried about. You know, this isn't just an environmental movement issue. This is something that's actually an economic issue. It's a social issue. It's an issue about your ability to have your voice heard in your local community. This cuts across all sorts of different walks of life. And if this precedent is created through this legislation, well, actually, it's a precedent that could be applied in other areas in the future. So it's not just actually about this particular bill, but if you've got ministers having this kind of power, well, actually that opens the door for all sorts of things in the future. It's a bit of a Pandora's box. So really highlighting that through the national media. And we've got great colleagues at other NGOs, and we work really closely with them. So EDS, Greenpeace, WWF. And the other thing we've been looking at doing is how we can support local mobilization. And part of that's about identifying likely projects. So next slide, please. So what can you do? And I'll talk a little bit about some of the resources we've got at our disposal to really help you as well. So there's some big asks, and we need your help, right? The more people who can stand up and give a voice to nature in this process, the stronger we will be. So what can you do? You can write an individual submission from your branch or your local group, and we will be providing a guide to help you with that. So what are the key points you can make? How do you go about it? Really looking at what we can do to support you for that. You can ask to speak to your submission at the Select Committee. Rock up to Parliament. Make sure that they're putting the local in front of people, right? Talk about your concerns. What matters to you? Frankly, if this bill's not going to allow your voice to be heard, make sure your voice is being heard now. You can also, we'll also signpost other people to a bit more of a generic submission template. So people who maybe don't want to kind of go into the detail, but still feel strongly enough to say, actually, I want to send in my support. We're going to have a generic submission that we can promote as well. The other thing is your local MPs. Make sure they know you're concerned. So we've sent out a template for a letter that you can write. Get in front of them. Meet with them. In particular, your national MPs. okay, and those issues. It's not just about the environmental concerns. They are first and foremost for us, but actually this is about, hey, as my local MP, are you going to back this legislation that isn't going to let me have my voice heard? Are you going to back a piece of legislation that's not letting this community have its say? Make them feel uncomfortable. And we've got that template for that. Local councillors, well, hang on, they're eroded. Some of their rights and responsibilities are being eroded as well. How do they feel? It's rather ironic that this is a national party that talks about small government and giving local people a stronger say, and actually they're doing the opposite. Three ministers, in the Beehive, in Wellington, really making bad decisions. That's a bit of a kind of against the grain. The other thing is, who are the local groups and concerned people in your community? How can you set up town hall meetings? How can you get people to create a situation where your MP is going to have to front up and talk to people? So you, especially if you've got like a likely project or something you're concerned about locally, something tangible, something real that people can say, I'm really worried about that. What are you going to do about it? How are you going to stand up for me in this parliamentary process? So there's those opportunities as well. We've also got our regional conservation managers who can work with you to reach out to kind of key allies, for example, local iwi. I'll talk a little bit more about that in a moment. Next slide, please. So just to give you a scale of what we're looking at, this is a little handy graphic that I nicked from RNZ. Those red areas are parts of public conservation which would be eligible for projects to occur under Fast Track. So you can see the scale of what we are talking about here. And I don't know about you, but there are places in there that I am deeply passionate about. So that red blob at the bottom of the North Island is the Tauradua Ranges. That is one of my happy places. It's also one of my wife's happy places. And when she's happy, it tends to make my life a bit easier as well. We love tramping in there. We love running in there. It's an incredibly special, beautiful part of the North Island. You've got the Kaimanawas in there. You've got the Ruahinis in there. You've got the Waitakaris in there. You've got the Hanuas in there. Apologies to people from the South Island. I don't know it that well, but I'm sure there are special places down there for you as well. Let's make this real. Let's bring it to life. So this isn't just about something which people don't know about. Let's make it places that people can identify with. This is our scary starter for 10. So we've done a bit of analysis around what we think might be on the list. So to give you a bit of a flavor of the kind of stuff we're talking about, Ruatanifa, Wakamoko, Tikuha, Denniston, Coromandel Oceania Gold, Balmoral Solar Farm, TTR, Wind Quarry Zelandian Taranaki, Waitaha, the Rakiura one, and then new housing developments left, right, and center across the country. This is national. This is urban. This is rural. These are scary, real projects. This is how we can bring this to life, by pointing out that these will be happening in your communities and that you are deeply concerned. Next slide, please. So we're here to help, right? We can all stand up. We're stronger together. So Mahi Ngatahi is about working together. It's the forest and bird way of doing things. And this is about branches, local communities, supporters, members, other local groups, iwi, Forest and Bird Nationally, other NGOs. We all need to work together on this. So what resources are out there for you? Letter to your local MP. We'll have that generic submission template for the general public. We will have a submission guide to help you basically get your submission in there. We'll keep you updated regularly through our e-news and Nature in Action about what we are hearing and what we are learning. The RCMs, our regional conservation managers, are out there in the region. They're there, questions, advice, support with action, and they are going to be working on the likely projects with you to try and mobilize action. We've got a comms team which can provide you advice on engaging with local media. We've got Pete and the fantastic legal team who are there to help with legal questions as well. Branch support, we've got these brilliant people who are out there working with our branches all the time. And in this time of crisis, in this time where we need action, they're here to help as always. And also, if you are doing things like town hall meetings or events and actions, we can help with kind of health and safety and managing risk in those situations as well. That's really important. We want to take action, but we want to do it the right way and keep everybody safe. Okay, next one, please. So, without further ado, you've heard enough from me. So apologies if I've gone on a little bit long. But this is something which, like all the others, I know I'm personally deeply passionate about. And I guess I would just commend this to you. Your voices matter. They matter to us. And we want to make sure they matter to those parliamentarians and those ministers who are driving this thing through. So without further ado, I'm very happy to hand back to Nick. Thank you.
Kia ora, Richard. I got a little bit carried away with trying to answer questions, so bear with. Can you guys see me, hear me? I think I've mucked around with my... oh, great. Hello again. Kia ora anō. So I really appreciate all your questions, and hence my slight technical fail there because I was desperately trying to answer some of them. So thank you for your patience, and thank you particularly to Richard and Pete for being able to articulate the things we are so deeply concerned about. And just to reiterate, you know, this is not a bill about fast tracking. We've had those before. We don't mind. We can deal with fast track legislation. This is absolutely about opening the way for developments to occur with no checks and balances and no controls whatsoever. And, you know, he did it publicly. So while I've been talking to you, Pete and Richard have been talking in particular, I had a wee look at old Matua Jones's Twitter profile. Met with former Wallaby, Nick Farr-Jones and other Aussies to talk about mining and the extractive sector. Dig, baby, dig. If you're not aware of that phrase, it's straight out of the Trump playbook. So we have a decision-making minister out there in public making it very clear that that is something that... unless, of course, it's a fake account, which I'll probably have to double check. But that is what we're up against. That's the nature of what we've seen in the media. And that is why we have to make it very clear that this stops now. So to your questions, I've seen a couple of them already. One of them is standby callers. Oh, I've been had them passing to me. Surely this is worse for our economy in the long run. We can't fish dirty waters or grow in polluted earth, not to mention the impact on tourism, which is one of our biggest earners. Correct. So pre-COVID, tourism, highest export earner in the country, just spoiler alert, they're not coming here to see our shopping malls. So, and if we talk about the benefits and the impacts, I was around when taxpayers had to fork out something in the order of $155 million to bail out the failed solid energy on the West Coast when the mine went under, right? So this is a known boom bust industry. We know that extractive industries are for the here and now. Most of it goes overseas and locals get left with the mess. This is not something that is going to prop up our economy in the long term for our generations and generations after us. And we will be doing some more work, thank you, on the figures around that to make sure that we are accounting for both sides of the ledger. You know, it is naughty of governments to talk about, particularly a government which, you know, posits itself as the government of business, to only talk about one side of the ledger. You and I all know that when we balance our checkbooks, we take a look at the costs as well as the income. Otherwise, it's just fibs. So it's really important that when you are talking to your local MPs, when you are writing your submissions, that you are very clear that there are costs to this and costs to communities and costs to our future generations. And we will be across that. Which brings me to the second question. Will Forest and Bird be mobilising younger people too? Yes! One of the joys of returning to Forest and Bird, having been out of it for a decade or more, is what wasn't in Forest and Bird, Te Reo Te Taiao, when I was in it last time around, was the youth network, which are some of our most passionate, articulate, educated, mobilized members that we could possibly have. And it's not fair for us to be ripping off our future generations by not supporting the amazing work that they do, not to mention the fact they are very, very good at the socials. And despite the fact I keep trying to tell them that I'm youth adjacent, I am in fact right smack in the middle of being middle-aged. So they are very useful in terms of their skills and their abilities, their networks, their mobilization, and the voice that they bring. And we work really hard to support them to have that voice in Forest and Bird. And it is something I'm probably one of the things I'm the most proud of. There are some questions for Richard and Peter at this point, so I'm going to mute and let them chip in.
So, Pete, I'll throw a couple your way. So, I'll just pop my video on so you can see
me. Okay.
There we go. Hey, Pete, will the Environment Court remain? And secondly, this legislation process seems illegal. Could this be challenged under JR or judicial review process in the court?
Sure. So in relation to the Environment Court, yes, the Environment Court will remain. What, as I kind of alluded to earlier, the government is proposing to review the RMA. Until that happens, the Environment Court will still have an important role to do, particularly in relation to plan making. So while it currently has an important role with respect to deciding these resource consents, which will be reduced through the fast track legislation, they'll still have an important role in many other areas, plan making, enforcement, those kind of things. So the answer to that question is yes. Who knows what will come out of the government's proposed RMA review? Second question about judicial review. Really difficult to challenge legislation. So you can't judicially review legislation. There are avenues available to do certain things. It's really difficult to work out what they are at the moment because we don't know what the bill's finally going to look like. But you can rest assured that we'll be looking very, very closely at the challenges that we can make to it. And there are definite opportunities for those kind of challenges. Possible options include bias from, for example, the decision makers. We've had Minister Jones advocating for projects left, right and centre. If he makes decisions on those, potential cases for predetermination and bias. The way in which the panel refers things, what the actual legislation means. So the summary of the answer is no, can't challenge the legislation through judicial review, can challenge the decisions that are made under it to refer projects, to make decisions on projects through judicial review. So we'll be looking pretty carefully at that, you can be sure of that. There's a question about whether it applies to activities in national parks. So no, it will not apply to... projects within national parks are ineligible for a fast track. They could be in the legislation. I think that's kind of unlikely. So the government can't refer projects in the national park, and it's probably unlikely to be there any in the listed in the bill. Although there could be, the many conservation areas are up for grabs. Stewardship land, forest park, conservation park, various reserves. It's only the most important conservation land, tenure, national parks, national reserves, etc., which are limited.
Yeah, but Pete, just noting that with respect to stewardship land, a bunch of that does have extremely high value. It just never got sorted in time, right? So it's not
absolutely.
Yeah. And while I've got the floor, because I can't help myself. There are a few questions in there about supporting the youth. There is a strike for climate protest on the 5th of April. Yes, we're absolutely supporting. So in your major centres, get in there and support your young people. And if you are, in fact, young people, we will be supporting you to make some noise with respect to this and get creative with your signs. I quite like the "I can't believe I'm still protesting this." It.
Totally agree. The fact of land being of stewardship land status is not actually a reflection of its value. You only have to look at the Denison Plateau, some of the most valuable ecological areas in the country, stewardship land. And stewardship land means you can get a fast track on it.
Probably just to add to that very quickly, just the national panel and look at the recommendations it made. 347,748 square meters to go into conservation park, 182,300 to historic reserve, 77,440 hectares to go into national park. So that's the bit of the stewardship land review that's been done already. So we're not talking about We are talking about valuable land here. We're talking about land that has strong environmental and ecological value. So this idea that stewardship land is not precious, isn't important, isn't conservation land. Actually, we've got the first stage of that whole panel process that has demonstrably demonstrated that that actually isn't the case. I'll pick up the next question. So a couple of people asked, is there going to be a template and support that will be provided? Absolutely. So watch this space. We're aiming to get that out as fast as we can. We're still working on a national submission, and we'll be getting the support out to you as fast as we can. In the meantime, though, don't just wait for that, right? There's that opportunity to go and talk to your local MPs. We've sent some information out already. The other thing that someone mentioned was really good call. Yeah, absolutely. Talk to your local boards. So local boards will be getting briefings on this. We'll be thinking about what this means for them. Again, any of those democratic mechanisms, whether they're politically affiliated or not, it's a chance to have your voice heard. It's a chance to make some noise and let people know that you care. So absolutely. So question for Peter, can the Waitangi Tribunal challenge this? And Nick, maybe you want to talk a little bit about the role of iwi in this as well.
I'm not that familiar with the Waitangi Tribunal, but I think it would be a challenge to get. I can imagine that there could easily be a claim brought in the Waitangi Tribunal. The government isn't bound by Waitangi Tribunal recommendations, so I suspect that the Waitangi Tribunal isn't a particularly, in the short term anyway, in terms of getting the projects stopped, is a particularly viable course of action. Particularly, it would have to be iwi that would take it anywhere. There are a few questions that I can quickly try and go through.
Do you want to do that? And you have a look at the questions and think up your answers, Pete. And I'm not going to speak for Te Ao Māori because that wouldn't be right. But I speak to a lot of friends and whānau and colleagues and contemporaries who are Māori, who represent iwi and hapū all over the place. So there are challenges with this, right? Because there are some settled iwi who have opportunities through Fast Track, but equally, there are a couple of things. So for settled iwi, if I think about Ngāi Tahu, for example, there is a long list of species at the end of the Ngāi Tahu Claims Settlement Act of taonga species, which they have rights and responsibilities for, that may in fact be at risk under the proposed legislation that I know they're worried about because I'm talking to them about it. I know that for, you know, one of the things, and I had a little conversation with Minita Jones about yesterday, because we have relations in common up north, is that for iwi, there's a couple of things. One is, and I know this deeply from my last role, is what happens at place matters to mana whenua, right? And so it's not okay to say, one of the things I've heard a lot from this government is, well, it's all right because we can wipe out a few frogs over here, but we'll be able to save some over there. That's not going to go down well with the mana whenua who have kaitiaki responsibilities for the frogs over here. That's not okay. So there are some significant infringements on the rights and responsibilities of mana whenua with respect to how this bill is posited, particularly those who have not settled. So for settled entities, there is some form of a pathway, but Section 4 of the Conservation Act, which says that the Department of Conservation shall give effect to the principles of the Treaty of Waitangi, is now out the window, because if a minister, one of the three, what did you say, Pete, wise men, decides that the Conservation Act is not relevant with respect to this, you know, particular development, then the Conservation Act is out and so is Section 4. So, you know, for iwi and hapū, I would be worried. I would be very, very worried, and I'd be talking at your local marae about what that means for you, because with respect to kaitiaki responsibilities, which are certainly not just about the here and now, and I have heard this chapter and verse and been very strongly told off about it on a number of marae, and I get it. It is about hundreds of years into the future. So, you know, I don't think any representative of any iwi or hapū can or would abide by the idea that they were ripping off future generations, because that's not part of the colour. And I don't think it's going to fly. I think this government are riding roughshod, not just over Te Taiao Nature, but of what it means, not just to be a New Zealander and the national identity that all of us, no matter what flavour of New Zealander we are, hold, but certainly for Māori, who whakapapa to the species that reside here. I don't think that's going to fly. I haven't heard a lot of noise with respect to local iwi, hapu, and the infringement on their rights with respect to this fast track bill, probably because they're out there dealing to all the noise about te reo and all the noise about te tiriti principles, but this matters. So, you know, if you are iwi hapu whānau, or if you are connected to them, have this conversation, because this is not just about te taiao, this is about who you are and where you stand. And these guys are going to take your at-place responsibilities well away from you and run right across the top of them, not just for you, but for your grandchildren, great-grandchildren, hundreds of years from now. Okay, Pete, hopefully that gave you some time.
So there's a couple of theme questions here which are asking the same question in slightly different ways. So the first one is, what about when the next government comes in and decides this was all a bad idea, what can it do? It can obviously repeal the Act and go back to status quo. What impact would that have with respect to projects that have already been unapproved? It would be quite radical for the new government to disallow or cancel the consents that have been granted under the fast track. In theory, it could do it, and James Shaw did make reference to doing that without compensation. That'd be a pretty bold move to do that. I think what the most likely situation is that the fast track bill won't be enduring. It won't last beyond this government. In the meantime, massive damage will be done in relation to projects that have been approved. A new government will come and repeal the Act, but it won't undo the consents that have been granted, because that would be as unconstitutional as the process in the first place of doing so. The second question is about land status for conservation land, I'll take that to a high level. The Department of Conservation manages a whole pile of what is called conservation land that varies in its underlying land tenure. So there's national parks, which are obviously managed under the National Parks Act. That's at one end, and then stewardship land kind of at the other. And there's a whole range of other different land tenures, and all those different land tenures are managed under different parts of the Conservation Act for slightly different purposes. So you've got, you know, ecological areas, you've got various types of reserves, scenic reserves, et cetera, et cetera. So the Fast Track Bill effectively makes projects ineligible, and Nick will recall this from her marching down the street, if they're on Schedule 4 of the Crown Minerals Act. So Schedule 4 of the Crown Minerals Act identifies areas where you can't go mining, and so that is things like national parks, nature reserves, scientific reserves, wilderness areas, wildlife sanctuaries, marine reserves. So the Fast Track Bill references Schedule 4 as to the types of land that you can't get a fast track on. So you can get a fast track on most conservation land by area. The most important conservation land has been excluded from consideration for being fast-tracked. As I said earlier, you could potentially get a listed project in one of those areas, but that seems kind of unlikely. And I think that is the questions. There's a question about a regional park at Whangaparāa. I don't know the underlying land tenure of that. A regional park is probably administered by the regional council, so that's not, you could potentially get a fast track over that, but I think it's reasonably, I wouldn't be too worried about things like regional parks. I'd be more worried about conservation land. I will see if there's any other questions that I can pass on.
I'll grab one if you like, Pete. So there's been a question: can you suggest fast track projects that are not conservation issues that the general public, who are not especially attached to, like the poor Archie's frog, could be upset about? I think there's a couple of issues here. One is we don't have that list. So the fact is that ministers have projects in mind that they've been talking to developers about, they've been talking to communities about. They know what that list is and they're refusing to share that. That's not good enough. So and there's a degree.
Sorry to interrupt, can't help myself. Worse than that, if you look in the bill, there's a blank page where the list should be.
Yeah.
I mean, this is nonsense.
Yeah, so this is disgraceful. And I think we'll keep pushing for that and keep embarrassing them in public as much as we can about the fact that that's not there. So in the absence of the list, we can make assumptions. But I think there's also the opportunity to look in. What's interesting about this bill is it actually names specific industries and specific types of economic activity, which previous legislation didn't. So it talked about aquaculture. So frankly, who's your local kind of fisher people? You know, your fish people who are interested in recreational fisheries. You know, actually, the idea of a fish farm being put in a space is something that they'll be upset about. What is at risk? That would be what I would be thinking. So what's at risk in your local community? What's at risk from housing development? What's at risk from infrastructure like roading? What's at risk from aquaculture? What's at risk from mining? What's at risk from irrigation? What are those special areas that could be at risk under this legislation? That's the way we're going to make it personal. It is going to be about capturing people's imagination about places they care about that actually are that this legislation would enable development and economic activity to take place on those. And it could be things like, you know, some of the tourism activities that we've seen kind of mooted that haven't made it into consenting process, some of the daft ideas over the years that, you know, people have come up with. Some of those things could be back on the cards. And I think the thing that's in front is that developers can have those conversations with ministers, but you can't. So your voice is shut out, but actually if you're someone with an economic or a business interest, you can have that conversation. That's not good enough. So can a minister that has publicly supported mining, e.g. Oceania Gold's and the conversation Shane Jones has had? There's quite a few examples of Shane Jones and things that he's said publicly. He's actually recused himself from TTR, I think, because of a conflict there.
Not Freddie, though.
Not Freddie, though. But I think this is some of the stuff that we can be looking at, right, which is where you've got public statements that have been made by ministers who are directly involved in decision-making. Actually, that would imply that there's clear bias and a clear conflict. So can we look at that? Someone's asked, is QE2 trust land subject to this? QE2 trust land, I understand from a presentation we had with Doc the other day, is outside of this. So QE2 covenants are still in place and still protected. Question for Peter. In a recent interview on Q&A, which I'm pleased to say that we did quite a lot of work behind the scenes to support that good interview, Chris Bishop said current consent applications underway may be terminated and proceed to a fast track. Presumably, this is because of section 14.3U in the bill. What legal avenue could be taken to challenge this? So this is people, and we've actually seen some of this already out there, and I think this is helping us understand what potential projects could be when, for example, sudden existing consents have been pulled. Or, for example, legal appeals have suddenly been withdrawn. It's giving you a bit of a clue about who's been talking to who. Anyway, Pete, I'll throw that one to you.
Yeah, I would just support what you just said, which is that, yes, we've already seen it. Te Kuha is the example. They pulled their High Court appeal. We're all expecting them to go for a fast track. So, yes, absolutely. There are other potential ones out there which have not yet been withdrawn but could be withdrawn. The Hananui Marine Farm down in Stewart Island is one. And we've already seen it with the Point Solar Farm in the Mackenzie. They've pulled their application to go for a fast track. So absolutely, what are the legal challenges to challenge this? Not much. Like, they're entitled to pick whatever route they want to go through. So we would have to just challenge them. We have to challenge them on the route they took, not their choice to withdraw and go in a different one. So that's slightly sobering material. That is the next one is who's going to be on the expert panels. And there's another question about who would convene them at the moment under the COVID stuff. There's a convener of panels who appoints the panels to hear the COVID. I suspect there'll be something similar like that. It's currently a retired environment court judge, so I suspect we'll have the expert panels appointed by a convener of of panels. I would expect there'd be something like the COVID rules, which talk about a lawyer of 7 years standing. I'm not sure exactly what that will be, but that's the kind of thing. That this is a real weakness for the process, because under the COVID fast tracks, they are struggling to get people to sit on their panels. And if they've got 100 rolling through, which is what the rumours are, then that's going to be very difficult logistically to manage. So that is a bit of a weak point in the process. But yeah, that's the answer to that question.
There's probably an integrity handbrake there too, right? Because you can't,
absolutely,
you know, the expert panels can only approve these developments. And so if you are an environmental expert and you are charged with only approving through what I consider a Clayton's panel situation, are you really going to turn up and put your hand up for something like that and keep your credibility? Hard to know. I reckon they're going to be scraping the barrel a little bit.
I agree.
I have a question here. How can the West Coast be better supported for this fight, given three projects in the top 10? Well, again, we don't necessarily know what the projects are. We're basically, what we're doing at the moment is digging, excuse the pun, as hard as we can to try and understand what we think those projects might be. So I can't claim to know what projects are. Various ministers have told me that they don't know either. I've got an eyebrow raised about that. But I suspect there will be, given what Pete just described about our court battle on Te Kuha and Stevenson suddenly pulling out of an appeal just as the fast track bill magically appeared on the horizon, there's probably some lines to be drawn there. How can we better be supported? That is the point. So for those of you, there's a lot of you online, by the way, and that is really great to see, and probably a good indication of how serious this is. That is the point of what we're trying to do as we move Forest and Bird into the next 100 years, Cathy and co, which is supporting the cohesion of the society to give nature a voice in the places that need it the most. So if you need it on the West Coast, then we'll try as hard as we can to back as much as we can to make that true. Given, so a little bit of calibration on that, we're pulled in lots of directions at the moment, but if that is, for example, if it turns out that is in fact in the top three of the mythical list that doesn't exist of 100 plus projects that we definitely have no idea and ministers definitely don't know about, then we will move to those. And if we have to, we'll start divvying it out, right? And that is why Richard talked about the fact that we are working with our ENGO friends and Greenpeace and WWF and EDS, and we are working closely and regularly on how we work together, you know, to be able to support this. And finding those friends and sometimes unlikely friends in places. I've been asking our farming community, for example, there'll be many farmers on the line right now, how they feel about, for example, the override of the Public Works Act. I know how proud farming communities are of their places, and I know who, I live in one. My house is on the front paddock of what was the front paddock of a third generation old school farm in North Canterbury. I know how those rural communities would feel about a monstrous big development right in their backyard, right? So finding friends in new places, diversifying our audiences, buddying up for shared outcomes, and leaving our differences on the other things aside for now while we focus on that middle of the Venn diagram is the most important thing we can do. So don't worry, we've got your back, and we will. Stretch resources notwithstanding, work as hard as we can to make that true.
And I'd probably just add to that, I think one of the things that's really powerful for us is if you can share your stories with us as well. So we can help you, but we need your help as well. So your local stories about what places mean to you, what's special, how you feel about things, the action that you're taking, that's really powerful for us, because a couple of reasons. One, it inspires us, it gives us, it helps keep our cups full. You know, this is hard, this is pretty painful stuff, right? And I know it will be for you on the ground as well, but hearing about what you're doing can really help inspire and motivate us as well, and vice versa. But please do share your stories with us. The other thing is, Let's get people into Forest and Bird, right? This is a rallying call. So this is about kind of become part of a movement, become part of a society that's been around for 100 years, that's got a legacy that we can build on. So support people who aren't members yet to join up. And it's an opportunity for people to support in all sorts of different ways, right? And the more of that there that's out there for us, the stronger we will be. And probably just echo what Nick said. You know, let's look for those relationships. Let's look for those allies. We are much, much stronger when we're working with other people. And I think one of the things that this government is finding, not just in this space, but in a couple of other areas, is that actually they've stirred a bit of a hornet's nest, and they are galvanizing people who maybe haven't worked together closely before to actually come together and put aside some of the differences. And that's definitely the case in this space. So let's seize that opportunity, because I think this isn't just about fast track. This is a war on nature, and we've got to gear ourselves up for a tough couple of years ahead.
Cheeky aside, I completely agree, and so do I can see that you all do, and that is a really salient point. Cheeky aside, I might have said to Minister Jones in our official meeting yesterday that he was supporting Forest and Bird in the biggest recruitment drive that we've had in some time, because boy, are people feeling motivated to join Forest and Bird who may not have been before. So, I know that there was a question here about did we just say the expert panel can only approve? Yes, the expert panel can only approve. They have no ability to decline. They can provide recommended conditions on projects, but they cannot turn it down. And if the ministers don't like the conditions, and I don't know how a minister would know whether or not they like the condition, of course, unless, of course, they had the ear, they were talking to developers, which they reckon they're not. But in any case, if they don't like conditions, they can throw it back to the expert panel, who can only approve. So that's really interesting. We don't like your conditions. Take them off. Okay, great. We'll put it through. If we have stories to share, how do we? Through RCMs, absolutely. You can talk to your local Forest and Bird branch members. You can get in touch with us any way you know how. Now, I'm just going to preface that, because some of you think that getting in touch with Forest and Bird is immediately emailing the CE. Unless you want to get a response a year from now, that's not the best way of doing it. So, because I just won't be able to get to it. It's not that I'm ignoring you. There's quite a lot on the go, as Richard had pointed out. Pete, do you want to just come in and correct my high-level overview of what I just described?
Yeah, so the question of whether the panels can recommend grant or decline is not that straightforward a question. The reality is that they won't be granted. They won't be recommending declines, because the way the Act is, the Act's purpose is set out, but there are different provisions in relation to different activities. So not they can recommend decline if there's inadequate information. So the suggestion that the board, the panels can't recommend decline is an oversimplification, but it's also probably the reality. Like, legally, in some situations, they probably can recommend decline. Will that happen in reality? Not the way the Act is framed.
Conscious of time, I've forgotten how long it's supposed to go, and I could probably talk all night, but we have talked for a while. I'm throwing to my minders here, because at any minute someone's going to send me a message saying this is what you need to do now, Nick. But genuinely, you know, I want to first acknowledge and thank everyone on this webinar for joining us. I've had a wee look at the names and can see how many people are on this call, and it is overwhelming, and rightly so, because these are overwhelming times when nature needs us most. And so I can see some very familiar names on there as well. It is lovely to see you all, and please stay connected with us. Don't let this be a one-off, because we can't afford for that to happen. Given that no one has told me, and thank you for all your support, please keep in touch with the Forest and Bird staff. If you are not a member of Forest and Bird, but you've joined us and you've really enjoyed the conversation, then by all means join us and get 10 friends to do the same. Because we're kind of, you know, I'm kind of looking forward to kicking this in the shins. I think it's time that New Zealand stood up for what we believe in and what defines us. And from everything I'm seeing, I think everyone is ready for that conversation too. So if this is in fact the end, she says, stalling for time, waiting for a message, haven't got one. I will finish by closing the door, as it were. Thank you all for your time. Please stay in touch. Genuinely, from the bottom of our hearts, while we're all working hard, we know how hard you're working in your communities, and we are so grateful for that. So stay in touch, and thank you. Yes, thank you. He karakia. Whakatake te hau ki te uru, whakatake te hau ki te tonga, kia mā kina kina ki uta, kia mā taratara ki tai, e hia ki ana te atakura, he tio, he huka, he hau hu, te hei, mauri ora, and we will see you all soon. Thank you very, very much.